Good morning, friends, and welcome to our worship this morning. It is Palm Sunday. See the lovely branches here in my hand, and also echoes the branches in this beautiful window behind me. This is First Presbyterian Church of Newcastle, Pennsylvania. I'm Reverend Lori Gearing Burick, the pastor here at First Presbyterian. And everyone here welcomes you warmly to this time of worship on this Palm Sunday. If you would like more information about where to find our worship, you can find it on our website. You can also find the bulletin on the website too, as well. This also, this Sunday also signals us and leads us into our Holy Week. On Thursday, you will see our Maundy Thursday service, which will be online at about 6:30 p.m. There will be communion with that service. And so I would encourage you to gather elements that you may have at home, a cup, juice if you have it, water, whatever you might have, bread, crackers, whatever it might be. Don't feel any stress about needing to go out and to purchase anything. Just gather those elements around you and be guided through that time of communion, remembering that Christ's presence is mystically present within us and within those elements. And having communion now in this time when we're forced to be separated draws us into a deeper understanding and a deeper experience of Jesus Christ that is within us, surrounds us, lives through us, and reveals to us the kingdom of God. My brothers and sisters, may you be blessed in this time of worship today. Blessed in your Holy Week and blessed in the Maundy Thursday service, which again, you'll be able to watch this Thursday at 6:30. May God's peace be with you. Good morning, and what a wonderful prelude that is. That was beautiful, beautiful music, beautiful sound, beautiful passion to the glory of God. And we thank our worship team folks who are here today. I'd really like to recognize them. They stay hidden during the taping, but we really should be able to recognize them and their talent that they give so freely. Don Rogers, who's our organist. We have a guest pianist today, Patty Vogley, and we have our worship praise team, which is Lydia and Madeline Ubrey. And I thank them this morning for getting our souls awake and our minds awake and our spirits just infused with recognizing that Jesus Christ is here with us today. And I welcome all of you here with us this morning to this worship, wherever you are watching, wherever you may be listening. We warmly welcome you. And if you would like to follow along with the worship today, there will be words that will appear up here on the screen. We also have our bulletin available on the website, on the First Presbyterian Newcastle website. So I would encourage you, if you would like to follow along with the bulletin, to check on that site too, as well. My brothers and sisters, Jesus Christ is here in this time and in this place. It is Jesus Christ who stands at the door of our heart and who knocks. And when we open that door and we invite him in, he has promised to come and be with us and to dwell within us. And so, my brothers and sisters in Christ, I invite you now to join your hearts together, your minds, your spirits together, as we start this service with a prayer of blessing. O holy God, O great love, gathering for worship today, we are like the crowd that lined the streets, witnessing your entry into Jerusalem. Some of us gather here full of enthusiasm. Some of us gather wearied by what life has thrown at us. Some of us have come out of curiosity, some of us out of habit. Some of us gather with great expectation, some of us with no particular hopes. It is here, O God, that you meet us and greet us, and if we will allow, it is here that you surprise us with your love and your grace. So open our heavy eyes and tired minds. Steal into our closed hearts and surprise us today with joy. Quell those unrealistic expectations, but open us to the possibility of hope and allow us to glimpse the goodness of your purpose for us. Fill this time of worship with your grace, with your peace, with your wisdom, with your light. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. My brothers and sisters, join your voices, your spirits together as we sing our song of praise. Blessed be your name.
So shall I be saved.
My brothers and sisters, as we prepare to seek God's forgiveness for our sins, I would invite you to recognize the power and the presence, the mercy, love, peace, and forgiveness of Jesus Christ that is here with us no matter where we may be today. Join with me, will you please, as we pray together the prayer of humility. Loving and forgiving God, even when we cannot name it ourselves, you know and you understand what ails us. You who created us, you know us better than we know ourselves. We submit to your knowledge of us, and we open ourselves to the need of your forgiveness, a forgiveness that comes freely and abundantly, a forgiveness that is a gift beyond all measure, a gift that we seek now in these quiet moments with you. Hear us now as we silently confess our sins to you. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Friends, with cleansed hearts and open minds, we join the cry, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. He who forgives, he who loves us. Friends, this is the good news of the gospel, that in Jesus Christ we are forgiven. This is, of course, the worship service that celebrates Palm Sunday. This is the beginning of our Holy Week in Christianity. It's considered one of the holiest weeks of our Christian year, of our Christian faith. And so this morning, we're hearing from the lectionary reading. The lectionary simply means the reading that most mainline denominations will be reading today. It also means that we have a year A, a year B, a year C, for those of you who may not be familiar with lectionary readings, which means that if we were to read all three readings that are available to us each year, A, B, and C, that the church would hear the entire Bible. And so today, in this year A, we are listening to the lectionary reading of Matthew 21, verses 1 through 11, and this morning I'll be reading from the Message. When they neared Jerusalem, having arrived at Bethpage on Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples with these instructions. Go over to the village across from you. You'll find a donkey tethered there, her colt with her. Untie her and bring them to me. If anyone asks what you're doing, say the master needs them. He will send them with you. This is the full story of what was sketched earlier by the prophet.
Tell Zion's daughter, look, your king's on his way, poised and ready, mounted on a donkey, on a colt, full of a pack animal. The disciples went and did exactly what Jesus told them to do. They led the donkey and the colt out, laid some of their clothes on them, and Jesus mounted. Nearly all the people in the crowd threw their garments down on the road, giving him a royal welcome. Others cut branches from the trees and threw them down as a welcome mat. Crowds went ahead, crowds followed, all of them calling out, "Hosanna to David's son! Blessed is he who comes in God's name! Hosanna in the highest!" As he made his entrance into Jerusalem, the whole city was shaken, unnerved. People were asking, "What's going on here? Who is this?" The parade crowd answered, "This is the prophet Jesus, the one from Nazareth in Galilee, the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God." So for some of you who may be watching this worship today, this may be a new story. For some of us, it's a familiar story. And I don't like to assume that when we hear these scriptural stories that we completely understand what is happening. And so we can appreciate the fact that there's a historical context, there's a contextual context, which means that the language, the words, have deep meaning, great meaning. One of the things that we can parse out of this scripture that's important, what I mean by that is to draw out of this scripture that's important, is how intentional the whole scene has been planned. Jesus, actually, in many ways, his life was in danger. When he rode into Jerusalem, he did this already knowing that his life would be in danger. And from the very beginning of the story, we have about half of the lines focusing on this little donkey and on the way that Jesus is going to ride into Jerusalem, into this city of David. In the culture in which Jesus lives, this Middle Eastern culture, the Jewish nation, and in their history, when a great leader rode into a city after a battle or facing a battle, the leader rode in on a steed, on a stallion. When a leader, when a ruler, when a king rode into a city in the way that Jesus is riding in on a donkey, it's a deep signal that this king, this ruler, comes in peace and comes humbly with deep humility. There's a reason why all of this story speaks to this humility and the intentionality of Jesus. There are those who want him destroyed. There are those who don't want him to have any more voice with the people, any more influence with the people, any more draw with the people. There are those forces that want to destroy him. And in essence, when he intentionally plans this riding into the city triumphantly as the king, as the Messiah, as the promised one, he does it throwing down the gauntlet and in essence saying to the powers that be that want to destroy him, "Bring it on. Bring me your best. Go for it." Because in doing this, you actually give God the opportunity to reveal God's great power and to reveal the power and the authority of God's kingdom in the world. It's probably antithetical to what most of us might consider if we were in danger, but not Jesus. We have a world right now that in essence looks at pageantry and looks at image and looks at prestige as being the authority. And it isn't. It's just image and prestige and pageantry. Nothing wrong with it, but that doesn't give a person authority. Jesus completely flips the coin on what we can understand authority is. by showing not only the people then, but us now and the world. You want to see the authority of God's kingdom? It comes humbly. It comes in peace. It comes riding in with mercy and forgiveness that will face what's coming to him, which is, we know, the crucifixion. He faces that with great courage, with grace, with poise, because he understands that God is doing everything in these moments for the benefit and the redemption of creation. My brothers and sisters, this is an unprecedented time for many of us. I know anxieties are high, worry is high. What might our future bring? And it is not a cliche when I say to you, when I encourage you, to keep your eyes upon Jesus. Go through this passion story. Go through this passion story. Pay attention to the language, to the actions of Jesus. Pay attention to his faith. Read through this passion. Luke has the best reading, I believe, the details in the story of the passion. And look to that behavior. Look to that word that Jesus gives. And I will tell you, my brothers and sisters, if you do this, the adrenaline that you will begin to have because of the peace of mind that you will be given and the courage that will rest upon your heart comes because of the authority of God's kingdom that is here, Jesus Christ said, within you already. I have revealed it. All we need to do is to take a hold of that, to allow that to transform our lives. Is it easy? Sometimes not. Other times, yes. But I would encourage you, especially this week, at the beginning of our Holy Week, to spend a little bit more time in the scriptures, spend a little bit more time in the prayer, in prayer. Allow God to speak deeply to your hearts, to your minds, to give you confidence, to give you peace of mind, to quell anxiety, worry, and fear, and to believe in the words that are given to us in Revelation, that when the angel blows the last trumpet, the announcement will be, and now the entire earth is the kingdom of God. My brothers and sisters, I encourage you now to turn your eyes upon Jesus, to open your hearts, open your minds, open your voices, and sing together our song, All Glory, Laud, and Honor. My brothers and sisters, I would invite you now to join together in our affirmation of faith. Christ Jesus, although he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness, and being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. God highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend in heaven and on earth and under earth, and every tongue should confess to the glory of God, Jesus Christ is Lord. Amen. My brothers and sisters, I would encourage you to continue to be in prayer for the finances of your own life, for the finances and the economics of First Presbyterian Church and the ministries and the programs that we have been entrusted with by God. This church has continued on for over 200 years, and we trust that God will bring it forward into the future. That happens in many ways. It happens not only with economy, but with time, with energy, and with gifts. And so in all of these things, my brothers and sisters, we lift this before God, we dedicate it to God, and we trust the fact that all those who will be guided to use the gifts, the talents, the energies that are offered to the congregation, through the congregation of First Presbyterian Church, to ministry, to program, to worship, will be given freely and trusted to God. We dedicate these gifts to you this morning, Lord, all of the gifts that have come in to First Presbyterian Church throughout the years. For those who have served in a myriad of ways and continue to serve in this difficult time, we thank you for the folks that are part of this worship where they are. We thank you for the ways that you are encouraging them to be faithful to their discipleship and their stewardship through their time, their prayers, their gifts, their talents. We thank you that in all of the ways that we are able to give to you, Lord, that we are able to trust to you, that those who use these gifts will indeed be filled and guided by your intelligence, your wisdom, and your compassion, so that these gifts and talents will always be used for the good of people, the good of the church, and the good of the world. And we thank you, Lord, that also as we lift our prayers to you today, and they are so many and so varied, we trust that in these moments you will continue to pour out your Holy Spirit upon us, that you will lead us in the way of Jesus Christ, that you will give us the courage to take up our lives, and in full reliance upon your grace, to follow Jesus Christ, to follow your still small voice of calm, to follow your wisdom and your intelligence. Help us to love you above all else, and to love our neighbor as we love ourselves, demonstrating that in love and in deed and in word, in the power of your Holy Spirit. Give us the strength to continue to serve you faithfully until the promised day of resurrection, when with the redeemed of all the ages, we will feast with you at your table of glory. Our loving God, we trust the fact that you are close today to all those who are suffering, for all those who are lonely, for all of those who are abused and addicted, for the poor, for the homeless, for the hungry, for the thirsty. We believe that your spirit of mercy and wisdom and grace is able to reside upon the minds of those who are in positions of authority, making decisions for the good of so many. We ask for not only this country, but for this world, Lord, for your healing power to come upon us and to guide us and to turn our eyes upon you, upon Jesus Christ, upon his courage, upon his power, and upon his strength. So that as we lift all things to you today, Lord, all of the things that we have spoken, that we have sung, that we have heard, that we have prayed out loud and in the deepest parts of our hearts, our minds, we trust the fact that you take it all into yourself, and by the power of your Holy Spirit, we trust the fact that life is truly transformed, so that we might rest assured that in the end, that all shall be made well, all shall be made well, all manner of life within Jesus Christ shall surely be made well. And we believe that you hear us now in the prayer that Jesus has given to us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. My brothers and sisters, as we close our worship this morning, again, I want to invite you in spirit and in song to join together in our closing hymn, Hosanna, Loud Hosanna. My brothers and sisters, remember you have the living God, the kingdom of God within you. You are called to take this kingdom out into your life, into the world, into every relationship and situation that you live in, that you move in, that you breathe in, and to never be afraid, for it is Jesus Christ who strides out before us. He goes ahead of us. He prepares a place for us. He waits there for us. And when we lose our way, I guarantee you, he will turn back on the road to meet you. And I bless you now in the name and in the power of our living God, who loves you more than you could ever imagine. And Jesus Christ, who is the living revelation of this life, this truth, and this way, and the Holy Spirit that binds you to God and to one another. Amen.